as well as some of the other areas to kind of talk to the citizens, find out a little bit more about what are the things that they're concerned about, and really focus in on those kitchen table issues. Of course, we're talking about Frank Ginta. You can find out more by going to teamginta.com. That is teamginta.com. Frank, how are you this morning?
I'm doing great, Jeff. How about yourself?
Outstanding. We'll talk a little bit about what you're going to be doing today as far as the campaign trail, but I do want to talk about some very serious issues. Really, the issues that Congress, I think, would like to be a little bit more involved in, but unfortunately, they're not being invited. I think they may have to push themselves a little bit more. The crisis in the Middle East, and basically when we look at Syria right now, we're about to lose a town. Many of us feel that this is something that we should have been more involved in one way or another. What is your sense about what is going on in the Middle East, and what are some of the things you think Congress could help out with that situation?
Well, I mean, it's getting worse every day.
Yes.
And there doesn't seem to be any real long-term strategy at this point by the president to eliminate ISIS. And you're correct. I mean, if a year ago the president had listened to Leon Panetta, as Leon Panetta has talked about very publicly, that he recommended to the president that they take action, you know, almost a year ago. If that were the case, Jeff, I don't think we would be in the current situation that we're in.
All right.
They only had 1,000 or so members of ISIS. They didn't have the same access to weapons and financial resources that they do now. And now we're looking at about 30,000 members of ISIS spread all across Iraq and Syria. Now they're moving toward the Turkish border. Turkey did take a vote to send troops, but so far all they're doing is making sure that there are no additional people that come into Turkey. They have not been proactive going into Syria yet. And these airstrikes just don't seem to be addressing the problem the way in which I think most Americans want the problem to be addressed, which is to eliminate ISIS. So that being said, Congress, in my view, should have and should take a vote on whether we're going to war or not. I think most people, if you ask them, they feel like we are at war. But the War Powers Act requires that vote to be taken, and that should have been taken before Congress went on recess for, you know, the month of October. They should come back. They should debate it. They should have a clear picture from the president to vote on in terms of what the strategy is. But it appears that's not going to happen until after the election, and that's, you know, very unfortunate. So I do think, Jeff, that we need to build immediately a coalition other than the United States from the region that's going to put troops on the ground led by American generals so we can get this job completed.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that. And I wrote an article on that a couple of weeks ago, and you're right. The War Powers Act it pinpoints a seriousness to the situation that we're trying to deal with in that region, and we all agree that we cannot let the status quo go. I know you still have colleagues and friends down in Washington, D.C., who are still part of this. How do they think, certainly when you talk about the relationship between the executive, the president, and Congress, how do they think that this is played out with that kind of relationship, or how the relationship should be in involving Congress in really their most important task?
Well, you know, my colleagues and friends in the House, both Republican and Democrat, continue to reference the lack of relationship that the president has with members of Congress. And this is, I don't think, much of a secret to a lot of people, but it never really gets discussed in a serious light. When you ask a Democrat who's serving in Congress off the record, because they probably won't really give you this answer on the record, but off the record, when you ask them, what kind of relationship do you have with the president? They are frustrated. They don't get a chance to meet with the president. They don't get a chance to talk to the president. And that was very different under Bill Clinton and George Bush.
Right.
You know, there was a relationship between the executive and the legislative. And I think that's important in any body, state, local, or federal, in order to try to get things accomplished, to build a relationship of trust. And when these kinds of issues come up, look, you have a clearer way of solving them. So I've got friends on both sides of the aisle who are very frustrated that the president continues to ignore Congress to a certain extent.
Well, and it must be frustrating, too, because, I mean, I like to remind everybody, too, you served as a chief executive. You were chief mm-hmm. executive in as mayor of Manchester. So you understand that relationship that it's, you know, it would be nice if all you got to talk to is the allies that supported everything you did. But occasionally you have to wander over and talk to people, especially if you have the same set of purposes in mind. And so I got to ask you, why do you want to go back down to Washington when you look at really some of the chaos that has been created over the last few years?
You know, I get that question asked all the time, and it's very, very simple. Our country is in trouble.
Yes.
And we need people who are going to have a set of principles, find people on both sides of the aisle that are going to get things accomplished on behalf of New Hampshire and the country. And I remind people that when I served in Congress, I was able as a freshman to get three pieces of legislation signed into law by this president. That demonstrates, I think, your ability to find common ground on certain issues and work with the other side, be respectful and responsible. And I think, Jeff, that's what people want. It doesn't mean you abandon your principles.
Right.
What it does mean is you can find people on both sides of that. And in this circumstance, I found common ground with the president on three areas. So I utilize the experience that I have in business as a chief executive and then as a legislator to try to find the areas that we can have that common ground, and hopefully those smaller items will lead to relationships and finding solutions on the larger issues that we have that America faces.
Well, absolutely, and you have to have those relationships. And I do want to remind everybody, I mean, you and Senator Ayotte both had that very same approach down there. You know, you find that common ground without abandoning your principles, and you can come up with solutions, which is good. Before I ask you about Ebola, because, you know, once again, this is something Congress, I think, should be playing a more active role in. I do want to ask you about this past week. Lou D'Alessandro appeared on with Jack, as he does his weekly appearances. My article last week was on the same topic. The topic has been very concentrated. Politico, The Hill, all of them are starting to write stories about New Hampshire in this one regard. Mm-hmm. Your opponent, the opponent in the 2nd Congressional, the opponent in the U.S. Senate, and in some of these other very close races that are confined within the state, they're not doing the New Hampshire way. They're not going out there. They're not exposing themselves to open and free forums and town halls. And it's now becoming very frustrating. I'm sure for you as a candidate, you'd like to be able to talk to your opponent, but it's getting very frustrating for us as citizens that this is not happening.
Yeah, I listened to that interview that Chuck Keith held, and you know, look, Senator Lou D'Alessandro, who's a Democrat, represents Manchester, was talking about if people like Carol Shea Porter and Annie Custer don't change the manner in which that they campaign, it can fundamentally change the importance of New Hampshire and the importance of the tradition of holding town hall meetings, of being accessible. And part of the reason, Jeff, that we have the First in the Nation primary is because we expect and demand accessibility.
Yes.
Yet we're not getting it from, you know, three quarters of our delegation right now. And I think that's important because I served, I came home every weekend, I was accessible by way of doing 20 town halls. When I was in New Hampshire, in Washington, I was doing telephone town halls. I came home and I did 20 town hall meetings, not just when things were good, but when I was taking votes that I knew some people wouldn't like. And I held those town hall meetings, and we had those conversations before and after votes. I think it's just an incredibly important aspect of the job to make yourself 100% accessible. And Carol Shea Porter, in this term, is completely opposite of the Carol Shea Porter that won back in 06.
Right.
She won, started her political career at a Congressman Jeff Bradley town hall meeting.
Right.
And followed him around to his different town hall meetings and gave her the direct access that she refuses to give, you know, the everyday citizen in the state. And I do think it's becoming an issue that people are frustrated with, realizing and saying to themselves, boy, in November, I you know, for no other reason, I'd like to you know, just have someone that I can access
right.
and talk to on a regular basis.
And it's so important. And you I remind people, too, is that, you know, you were right. Even at times when things weren't going well down in Congress, you still made yourself available. You also did the jobs fairs that people forget about an awful lot. And that kind of constituent service is just vital to New Hampshire's politics.
You know, New Hampshire is a small state, and as a result of that, we need to have a very strong delegation, a very aggressive delegation when it comes to issues that are important to New Hampshire, because we're competing with large states like California,
yeah.
Florida, New York, Texas. It makes it very, very difficult. So, you know, constituent service, listening to what people require of you is an incredibly, you know, important component. I mean, just yesterday I was with Senator Ayotte,
yeah.
you know, at a public event. There were, you know, I'd say in Hampton, over 100 people, you know, at this business forum, open to the public. And I looked at the room, Jeff. There were Democrats in the room.
Yep.
So I think, you know, allowing ourselves to answer questions from anybody who wants to answer a question, I think, ask a question is incredibly important. And Carol Shapiro is just... I think it's a strategy now to stay below the radar, do as few
That's
public
terrible.
Events as you possibly can, and do only the bare minimum. And that, New Hampshire just deserves better.
Oh, I agree, absolutely. And I'm glad that you are out there, out and about. It's unfortunate that you sat in this studio all by yourself. Well, you had Jack and you had John. But it's unfortunate that's the mechanism we're seeing in this state. And it certainly is foreign to me. I was raised here my whole life, and it's frustrating. Hey, before we let you go, once again, we're talking to candidate First Congressional District, Frank Ginta. You can find out more by going to TeamGinta.com, TeamGinta.com. I have to ask you about Ebola. So this is, once again, another crisis. It's just seems week after week these crises come up. Many of us felt that this crisis could be avoided. This is another case I feel Congress could be playing a much more active role. Overall, your thoughts on how to deal with this Ebola crisis?
Well, I think the first sort of line of defense is to ensure that Americans don't get affected and that the virus does not go viral here in America. So it really behooves me. I wonder and question why there is not a travel ban to different parts of the West African countries that are affected. And you know, I've heard people say, well, then you can't get supplies in and out. Well, the travel ban would exclude, you know, trying to get supplies in mm-hmm. and out to stop the virus and to help those who are affected in West Africa. But you know, let's protect American citizens, and until this is complete, put in a travel ban, number one. Number two, a number of the countries like China and Russia that do business in Africa and West Africa are doing nothing, not lifting a finger to help the people
right.
of these African nations, which, again, is just shocking to me, and it's why the world looks to America, because America has a heart. America wants to, you know, try to help people in these circumstances, but we have to have greater participation from other countries. You know, the president, I think, is, I would have handled things a little bit differently.
Mm-hmm.
I would have put the travel ban in, number one. I would have quarantined every individual, you know, over in Africa that was affected. He did send over 4,000 troops. But there's a whole host of other things, you know, with other countries that you can do to eliminate and eradicate the virus first control it, contain it, and then eliminate it over in West Africa. And I think that's where we're missing the opportunity to finish this before it gets, you know, far worse.
Well, right. And once again, we're talking to Frank Ginta before we let him go. I mean, one of the issues, too, is that we did send the troops over, but there doesn't seem to be any coordinated effort on the ground. You know, our group is certainly doing a great job and stellar work over there, but they seem to be acting independently. And to your point,
yeah.
We really need to get more people in a coordinated effort.
There needs to be a coordinated effort because this can be a worldwide epidemic.
And yeah.
I think logic and reason suggests that when you have a crisis that can potentially affect the world does need to respond mm-hmm. in a strong way. And that's why, you know, I cited China and Russia, who do a lot of business in West Africa,
yes,
And it seems like they could care less about the situation. So to me, travel ban for the United States, you know, let's protect American citizens, you know, get a coordinator. But again, Jeff, this also just leads to lack of leadership. I mean, we it just feels like we're always a little late to the game. Our president, in terms of trying to address these issues, and I just don't understand why that's the case. I mean, the people are scratching their heads asking why we don't have travel ban, and it's not, again, going back to asking Carol Shea Porter that question.
Yeah,
you can't ask her that question because she won't go on your radio show. She refused. You know, she did not go in the WGIR debate. She's not accessible, so you can't even ask your current member of Congress how she feels about the president on this particular issue.
That's a good point.
I mean, and that's what's frustrating people in New Hampshire. They have no idea where she stands on a whole host of incredibly important issues.
That's a really good point. Frank, we have to let you go. What's the campaign look like today?
We're going to Chester, and then I've got my daughter's soccer game, and I'm going to Rochester for the October Festival, and then I'm out to Hampton for another festival, and then I'm knocking on doors in the Seacoast after that.
So, good for you. That's a busy
day. Finding family time in there as well.
Outstanding. Good luck on the soccer match, and we'll talk to you real soon.
Sounds great. Thanks, Jeff.
And once again, that was Congressman Frank Kinta. Of course, you can find out more by going to teamkinta.com. We got to take a break. We'll be right back with another candidate for the District 20 New Hampshire State Senate. We'll be talking to Eileen Landes and find out what's going on with her campaign as well. All next on New Hampshire Perspective.